Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2024. I've received apologies for today's meeting from Ruth Maguire MSP, and James Dornan MSP is attending as a substitute. Today we begin our scrutiny of the Abortion Services Safe Access Zone Scotland Bill. As Gillian Mackay MSP is the member in charge of the bill, Gillian will not participate in the committee's scrutiny of the bill by virtue of Rule 9.13A2B. Ross Greer MSP will attend in her place as a committee substitute by virtue of Rule 12.2A.2. Welcome, Ross. The first item on our apologies, by virtue of Rule 12.2.38, Gillian Mackay MSP is attending the meeting today as the member in charge of the bill, and welcome, Gillian. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 5 in private and whether to consider in private at future meetings evidence heard at those meetings as part of its stage 1 scrutiny of the Abortion Safe Access Zones Scotland Bill. Are members agreed? Thank you. The next item on our agenda is a presentation from Emily Otley, who undertook commissioned research for the committee on an international comparison of abortion safe access zones legislation. Welcome, Emily. I invite you to give a presentation of no more than 15 minutes, after which I'll invite members to ask questions.
Lovely, thank you. Okay, good morning. My name is Emily Otley, and I'm a lecturer at law in law at the University of Winchester. And as you've just explained, I was asked to undertake an international comparison of safe access zone legislation in order to support the committee scrutiny of the Abortion Services Safe Access Scotland Bill. And I conducted this research using secondary research methods, specifically doctrinal analysis of the relevant legislation and case law, and a literature review, principally of parliamentary reports, but also relevant academic literature where this was available. So I've looked at safe access zone legislation from England and Wales, Northern Ireland, New Zealand, the Isle of Man, Australia, Canada, the USA, and the Republic of Ireland. And then within Australia, Canada, and the United States of America, there's a variety of safe access zone legislation. All 8 Australian states and territories have safe access zone legislation. 6 Canadian provinces have safe access zone legislation. And then 4 states in the USA have safe access zone legislation. So in total, I looked at 24 jurisdictions and their safe access zone legislation. The Safe Access Zone Bill in the Republic of Ireland is currently making its way through the Irish Parliament, so it's not yet law. It is widely expected that the government bill will eventually become law, though, of course, there may be some differences from the bill as passed by the Dáil in November 2023, which is what I used in my research. And I should also add that given the sort of scope of this research, I haven't examined the Scottish bill as introduced in detail. Spain is another country that has safe access zone legislation. But I excluded this jurisdiction from my research due to difficulties in accessing the law in English, and also Spain has a civil rather than common law legal system, which made it different. In relation to each safe access zone law, I considered the details of the provisions contained within the legislation, the context informing the introduction of the legislation, any challenges encountered during or after the passage of the legislation, and also the impact of the legislation. So I'm just going to summarise my 4 key findings. I don't want to speak for very long, just so that there's plenty of time to respond to members' questions. My first key finding concerns the details of the provisions that are contained within the legislation. So safe access zone legislation is characterised by creating, or providing for the creation of, a protective area around premises where abortion services are provided. However, the details of the provisions contained within the safe access zone legislation I looked at vary quite considerably between jurisdictions, particularly with regard to the method for the creation of the protected areas, the size of the protected areas, the behaviour that is prohibited within the protective areas, and also the penalties for violating the law. So I'll comment briefly on each of those elements, and then the 4 comparison tables included at the end of my report provide further detail. First, with regard to the method for the creation of the protected areas, the key point of distinction really is whether safe access zones apply automatically to all premises where abortion services are provided, as in England and Wales, or whether there is some additional step that's required to create a safe access zone outside a particular premises. And that additional step may be mere notification by premises operators, as in Northern Ireland, or it might be a more formal application and review process, like the one that's been established in New Zealand. Alternatively, legislation may afford some official a power to either create safe access zones, as in the Australian Capital Territory, or to identify protected premises, which you can see in Alberta and Nova Scotia. Second, with regard to the size of the protective areas, this typically falls somewhere between 50 metres and 150 metres. However, the protective areas in the US legislation are noticeably smaller. The largest in Colorado is 100 feet, which, if my maths is right, is approximately 30 metres. Colorado and also Montana in the US then have an additional smaller floating zone around persons who are within that larger fixed zone, which is essentially to prevent protesters approaching clinic users and staff outside the clinic. A key distinction with regard to the size of the protective areas is whether or not there is scope for extension or reduction of the protective area. So in England and Wales, for example, all safe access zones are 150 metres. That can't be extended if 150 metres is insufficient, nor reduced if 150 metres is excessive. In contrast, a safe access zone in Northern Ireland is 100 metres as standard, but it can be extended up to 250 metres for a particular clinic where 100 metres would not be adequate to afford safe access to the premises. In Queensland, Australia, safe access zones are 150 metres as standard, but a smaller or greater distance can be prescribed by regulation. And Queensland is actually a relatively rare example of the law allowing the protective area to be reduced in size, not just extended. And Queensland is also fairly unusual because it doesn't set an upper limit for the extension of safe access zones. The size of the protected areas is sometimes connected to the method of creation for the protective areas. So quite often where the protective areas aren't created automatically, the size of the area will be determined on a case-by-case basis as part of the process for establishing a protective area. And there may be an upper limit set out in law for that, as in New Zealand, or a minimum size, which you can see in the Australian Capital Territory. Third, with regard to the behaviour that is prohibited within protective areas, both England and Wales and Northern Ireland prohibit any act that is done with the intent of, or reckless as to whether it has the effect of, influencing a person or their decision, obstructing or impeding access to the premises, or causing harassment, alarm, or distress. In contrast, most other jurisdictions specify particular behaviours or activities that are prohibited. And the prohibited activities and the way they are formulated in the law varies, but some kind of common examples include recording persons, obstructing or impeding access to premises, threatening and intimidating persons, expressing disapproval of abortion, advising or persuading persons from accessing or providing abortion, informing persons on matters relating to abortion, and continued or repeated observation of premises. And again, the US stands out, particularly in Colorado and Montana, where all that is prohibited is protesters physically approaching clinic users and staff in close proximity to the premises. And then finally, with regard to penalties, all the jurisdictions I looked at impose fines, although the amount varies. The key distinction there is whether or not imprisonment is also a possibility. So anti-abortion protesters who violate the law can be imprisoned in most Australian states and territories, with the exception of the Australian Capital Territory, most Canadian provinces, with the exception of Quebec, 3 out of the 5 US states, and the Isle of Man. And at the moment, there is currently provision for imprisonment in the Irish Bill as well. But notably, imprisonment is not an option in England and Wales, Northern Ireland, or New Zealand. So Moving on from the details of the provisions contained within the legislation to my second key finding, which concerns the context informing the introduction of the legislation. Typically, safe access zone legislation is passed in response to concern about current or future protest in the vicinity of premises where abortion services are provided, and a desire to ensure good access to abortion services. In England and Wales, the number of women who are currently affected by protests was emphasised in the parliamentary debates, and elsewhere the frequency, continuity and severity of protests have been relevant, and in some places a perceived escalation of some kind has been significant. The Isle of Man's a really interesting example because there hadn't really been any protest activity of the kind we're talking about. But after anti-abortion protesters had visited the island to protest against proposed reform of abortion law more generally, members of the House of Keys were concerned that the Isle of Man would experience more protest activity, including outside premises where abortions are provided, once abortion was more widely available there. So there was a perceived risk of anti-abortion protest activity in the future. And we see this elsewhere. There was concern in South Australia that the state would become the only Australian state without safe access zone legislation, and therefore protests would become a big problem there. The existing lack of legal measures that could adequately deal with protests in the vicinity of premises where abortion services are provided was a common justification for safe access zone legislation across all the jurisdictions I looked at. But interestingly, those who opposed the passage of safe access zone legislation would often argue that laws already existed that could respond to the perceived problem. Often, but not always, provision for safe access zones is made alongside or shortly after broader abortion law reform that liberalises access to abortion services. So the Isle of Man is a good example of the former, and Northern Ireland and New Zealand the latter. However, England and Wales, and indeed Scotland, doesn't fit that pattern. And just to note that the climate of severe anti-abortion violence is unique to the United States, though there have been instances of anti-abortion violence in both Australia and Canada. And that sort of unique context is reflected in the US law, which, as I've already mentioned, is quite noticeably different to the other jurisdictions I considered as part of my research. Moving on to my third key finding, which concerns the challenges encountered during or after the passage of the legislation. And I think it stood out quite clearly to me that the most significant challenge encountered both during and after the passage of safe access zone legislation has been in achieving a satisfactory balance between the rights of those who wish to protest at clinics and then clinic users and staff. And of course, it's necessary to strike an appropriate balance in order to comply with human rights and or constitutional obligations. And this challenge is really clear from the parliamentary debates, where those who oppose safe access zone legislation criticise bills for going too far, and others struggle to frame the bills in such a way as to strike that appropriate balance. So there's a really close connection here between this challenge and the details of the provisions contained within the legislation, particularly with regard to the activities that are prohibited within the protective area. The challenge is also clear from a number of court cases in Northern Ireland, Canada, Australia and the USA that were brought by protesters who claimed that safe access zone legislation violated their rights and the rights of other protesters. Most of those legal challenges have been unsuccessful, including the challenge to the Northern Irish law. So the UK Supreme Court acknowledged that making it an offence to do an act within a safe access zone with the intention of, or being reckless as to whether it has the effect of, influencing a protected person interferes with protesters' rights to freedom of thought, conscience and religion, freedom of expression and freedom of assembly under Articles 9, 10 and 11 of the European Convention on Human Rights. However, the court ultimately concluded that this interference was proportionate and therefore the law was compatible with the convention. And a second challenge, which I think is worth briefly mentioning, is a delay in safe access zones coming into effect outside premises providing abortion services once that legislation has been passed. So we might expect that kind of delay where zones aren't automatically created and instead are subject to an application process, as in New Zealand. But there's also been a delay in England and Wales. So the relevant bill received royal assent on the 2nd of May 2023, but the section which establishes safe access zones is still not in force. Well, it wasn't when I checked last night, anyway. It's expected to sort of happen soon. There's publication of non-statutory guidance coming, and the commencement of the relevant section will follow in due course. There's been a consultation period on the draft guidance, but I'm not aware at the moment of a specified date. And then my fourth and final key finding, which concerns the impact of the legislation. The availability of evidence on the impact of safe access zone legislation is generally very limited, though there has been some academic research on the efficacy of safe access zones in Australia by Ronley Sifris and Tania Penovic. And they interviewed professionals from across Australia and concluded that the safe access zones were achieving their objectives of protecting the rights of patients and staff to privacy, facilitating safe access zones, facilitating safe access to services without fear, and also in reducing misinformation and stigma. And although the researchers noted that some protesters had maintained a presence outside the protective areas, they thought it was the distancing away from the premises that was significant. And I suspect the lack of evidence and research to date is at least in part due to the fact that much of the safe access zone legislation has been passed only very recently. Sources cited in my report have called for further research to be done in due course. And the legislation in Northern Ireland and the bill in the Republic of Ireland do actually require a review of the efficacy of both safe access zones and the operation of the Act. So that might prove to be a useful source of impact in the future. Thank you for your attention. I look forward to answering members' questions.
Thank you very much, Emily. And I'll open up now to members' questions. Ross.
Thanks, Commissioner. Just on that final point, Emily, around the how recent most of these measures have been implemented, so the lack of evidence on impact. Is there even any anecdotal indication in terms of the reaction from those who were for and against it? Because there is a bit of a difference between actual impact versus perceived impact here. But were you able in your research to even just pick up the reaction of those on either side of the debate once the schemes had been implemented in their areas? Did they feel it had had an impact?
Yeah, I think definitely when you read particularly anecdotal evidence from service providers and clinic users, it's generally very positive, even when a presence of protesters has been maintained outside the zones. They seem to feel better because they're kept further away, it seems. In terms of reaction of those who kind of opposed, I haven't come across much other than where challenges have been brought in the courts, but people on the whole seem to feel better when you read anecdotal reports.
Thanks.
Sandish.
Thank you. Thanks for the presentation. I've got a couple of questions. The first one revolves around what has been said about a slippery slope argument in other jurisdictions where you have this brought in for a very specific reason, and we're all aware this is very specific, and the scope of the bill is very tight. It's about this. But this bill also says something about private dwellings. So the slippery slope argument that, well, we'll bring this in here, but maybe we'll then be able to say, well, we'll do something else a little bit later, and we'll do something else, and we start to erode what happens within a private dwelling.
Lovely, yeah, thank you. So I haven't seen the phrase slippery slope used in any of the reports that I've seen. But there are concerns, particularly about the fact that legislation is often targeting abortion in particular, so people are often concerned about that. Although I'm not sure I've seen concern about it spreading, the concern seems to be more that why isn't it applying in general as opposed to targeting abortion. With regard to private dwellings, you can see that in Canada and also some of the US, not the buffer zone legislation itself, but some of they've got other legislation that protects like doctors and clinic users' home, clinic staff's homes. You can see in some places as well, say US, maybe Canada, the same kind of legislation being used for anti-vax kind of protests. So particularly out of COVID-19, you saw some of those. And interestingly, there seemed to be less opposition to that than the abortion safe access zones. So one of the Canadian states that doesn't have safe access zones for abortion does have safe access zones for anti-vax type protests, which is interesting. Or something else I was going to say, and it's now slipped out of my mind. Have I answered your question? Something else I was going to say. It doesn't seem to have been a major concern. The bigger concern was that why are you picking on this very narrow thing?
Okay. And the other question, especially in other places, is revolving around silent prayer.
Yes.
It's a very... firstly, it's sometimes impossible to know, but sometimes it is, if you're standing in a circle, for example. But if you are silent, you don't have signs or anything. And one of the other things to talk about here, and I'd like you to touch on if you can, is, you know, if you are a nun or a priest, then you're more than entitled to wear what you want. It's different to me putting it on and going and standing, which is going to be overt. So the question revolves around that silent prayer and for ordinary members of the public, but then also for more specifically clergy, nuns, and people like that.
Yeah, really good question. It varies depending on jurisdiction about whether or not silent prayer is included in the prohibited activities. So I know in one of the jurisdictions, the point was actually made that silent prayer wouldn't be included because the wording of the prohibited activities included protest and they didn't regard silent prayer as an act of protest. However, where the legislation is framed more broadly so that it prohibits any act that has like a consequence of, silent prayer tends to sort of fall within that. And it's kind of outside the scope of this research, but there is other research that looks into the effects and impact of silent prayer on people accessing clinics. And I think when you read through some of the parliamentary reports, they cite a lot of that research about what is the impact on silent prayer on people. And they talk about how the fact that you're doing it very close to a clinic can be the problem, as opposed to kind of doing it somewhere else. It's more than just silent prayer, is what comes across from the parliamentary reports. Silent prayer has been a big issue in the English and Welsh legislation, in the sense that at the very final stage, there was some amendments tabled, and one of those included specifically excluding silent prayer from the legislation. That wasn't successful. But in the draft guidance that was published recently that they've just closed the consultation on, silent prayer seems to be excluded from that guidance. So the government were kind of accused of watering down the protection from the legislation. So that's kind of silent prayer. And just while I was kind of talking about that, I remembered the other point I was going to say in regards to your first question, which was that England and Wales, again, is unique in the regard that it's within general protest legislation. So if you look at most of the other jurisdictions, safe access zones for abortion are either a standalone piece of legislation or they're within abortion legislation more generally. But in England and Wales, the safe access zones are in quite controversial protest legislation. So I wonder if there might be a connection there in terms of not necessarily a slippery slope, but it's linking to broader protest in that sense. Is that answering your question?
Yes. Do you think you might expand on that a little bit?
In terms of?
Just that point about the difference between it being in protest legislation and not. I just maybe haven't quite understood the relevance of that, and if you could maybe just expand on that.
It's just that it's seen as, I suppose, well, different people see it in different ways, of course, but I think there might be a perception, and that kind of comes across in some of the Hansard reports, that anti-abortion protest outside clinics is being lumped together with normal protest, whereas advocates of safe access zone legislation tend to see the protests outside abortion clinics as being of a very different nature, as being something unique. And you read sort of comments like, it's not real protest, it's more like harassment. And so I was just thinking, in terms of your slippery slope point, that in England and Wales, at least, some people might argue or might think that that looks like it's already happened, because there's other protest restrictions on protest within that broader legislation.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, convener. Just on the back of Sandesh's question about silent prayer, does the other legislation look at the number of people standing outside a clinic, for instance? Because there is a difference between one person that might look like they're a minister or a priest or something, versus 10 people. So does the legislation cover when is it okay to walk into a place or stand outside and in silence?
Yes, so as far out of the legislation I've looked at, that there's none that kind of set, you know, a limit on X number of people is okay or not. They also are quite broad, I think, generally, in what they prohibit. So they generally tend to prohibit as opposed to spelling out what would be okay. So you're left in a kind of a bit of a guessing game about what would be okay. I have seen, and it's not legislation, but in England and Wales, where they've been currently relying on PSPOs, Protective Space Protection Orders, as kind of in the meantime, they act a bit like a safe access zone. The one in Ealing has a designated area set up for protest. And I think really out of the laws I've looked at, that's the only example of somewhere that has kind of specifically said what is okay. Is that answering your question? I haven't come across anything else.
Okay.
Carol Morgan.
Thank you, convener. Thank you very much. It's been really useful. I'm interested in, you said that some of the legislation you'd looked at actually does list prohibited behaviours, but I think the sense we get here is that we're likely to not go for that option. So I just wondered, in terms of the people who have to implement the law, is there anywhere that they're indicating whether they found one way better or the other?
Yeah, I think that's definitely some of the concern, particularly when you read some of the parliamentary debates about how will we characterise a particular behaviour. So some of the legal challenges in terms of the human rights compatibility have said, like, oh, well, we could prohibit this behaviour, but not this behaviour. You see that was the root of the Northern Ireland challenge, really. And the Supreme Court were kind of like, well, for the people who have the police and clinic staff, how are they going to characterise whether what you're doing is sort of meaning to influence or harass someone, or you're just doing one of these okay things? And that's why, although the legislation that lists prohibited behaviour does list it specifically, they do, when you look at it, kind of list pretty much everything you can think of. And that is in an attempt to make it easier to enforce, because if you were to try and that makes sense, if you try and characterise an interaction between two people, it's very difficult to know what's going on. And you see that really in the Northern Ireland Supreme Court judgment.
Thank you.
And back to Emma Harper.
So it's a different subject, I suppose. It's about like the rights of protesters versus the rights of a woman who's seeking an abortion. And in our briefing papers, it says that United Nations Committee on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women found that several aspects of the law on abortion in Northern Ireland at the time violated women's rights. And as part of their report, they made a number of recommendations that was to protect women from harassment by anti-abortion protesters by investigating complaints and prosecuting and then punishing perpetrators. So I'm interested in aspects where the rights of women seeking medical care kind of supersedes the issues of somebody's right to protest and free speech.
Yeah, and you see that, again, going back to the Northern Ireland UK Supreme Court judgment, the court do explicitly say that we are prioritising the rights of women accessing abortions. Obviously, they talk about their justifications for doing that, but they do make that point that they are prioritising those rights. You see throughout the court judgments and the parliamentary debates this constant kind of balancing act about we need safe access zones, but how do we frame that in a way that does achieve a balance? So you'll have those who oppose safe access zones who will say that, you know, by virtue of having them, you've achieved the wrong balance. But generally, when you look through the parliamentary reports, that's what most of the time is spent on, is, you know, if we phrase it this way or we prohibit this behaviour, are we going a bit too far? Are we tipping the balance the other way? So it's as I said, it's really the biggest challenge with this kind of legislation. But it comes out more clearly that the CEDAW report doesn't mention the rights of the protesters there. I guess they had quite a narrow focus, but the parliamentary reports and the court judgments do.
Okay.
Ivan McKee.
Thanks very much, and thanks for your research on this. It's very interesting. A couple of questions regarding impact and where we are. So you mentioned, I think, a couple of legal cases that have been unsuccessful. Are you aware of any legal challenges that have been successful? That's the first question. And the second question was where the legislation is in place, have there been convictions or charges brought, I suppose? Now, clearly, you're looking at this in a global sense, and some of the jurisdictions will be very different, but in jurisdictions, perhaps Ireland and others that are more similar to Scotland, be interested to get your perspective on that. And then I've got another follow-up on the UK legislation after that, so thanks.
Cool, yes. So in terms of successful challenges in the US, there was an earlier version of the Massachusetts law than what is there currently. And that made it an offence to knowingly enter or remain within 35 feet, so about 11 metres of the premises. And the US Supreme Court held that that was unconstitutional on the ground that it placed too great a burden on the protesters' First Amendment rights to free speech, and it struck that law down. But it did, and that's the only example I've found of that happening with safe access zone legislation. So, for example, the Supreme Court upheld the Colorado law. I know that there are more cases that I didn't look at in detail for the purposes of this research, where they look at effectively safe access zones that have been created through other means, so other than legislation. So sometimes in the US, they're created by injunction or by like local council kind of ordinances. And there have been more challenges in regards to those. And I think some of those might have been successful, but I haven't looked at those for this, so I won't comment on that. So, yes, there is an example of a safe access zone being struck down in the US. In terms of convictions, yes, within England and Wales, there have been some arrests, investigations, and attempts at prosecution with regards to the space protection orders. So there's some examples of that. In Northern Ireland, there's also been reports, I think I linked to a BBC News article about continued protests in an area and the police being involved in those. You sometimes see, particularly with regards to the PSPOs that we've got at the moment in England and Wales, that charges get dropped, so someone might get arrested, there might be an investigation process, but that doesn't often get through all the way to conviction. Some of the legislation, just kind of thinking off the top of my head, talk about setting out warnings first, so going down the kind of arrest route isn't always the first port of call. Some of the legislation requires either kind of a warning or removal from the zone at kind of first instance. Then there might be kind of an arrest or investigation. So, yes, there definitely is examples of that happening. And when you read some of the sort of reports around this, some people will say, well, that's evidence of it not working. And some people will say, no, that's evidence of it working because you're arresting and prosecuting them.
Can
That's fine. I suppose the area, and it'd be too early to say, is how those charges, if and when they're brought, progress in terms of giving some clarity on what behaviours are or are not acceptable or fall within the legislation. But I suppose it's too early really to understand that. The other point I was going to raise was just following up on this discussion about the UK legislation. So if I understand it correctly, the zones, the abortion zones within that legislation are couched in terms of broader zones within other protest activities. Is that correct? So, for example, people protesting outside workplaces because they're not happy about what's manufactured there, or outside other facilities because they're not happy about something else that's happening in a specific area, or other forms of political protest. Is that how it's framed in the UK legislation?
I think, Mayor, I didn't explain it super well. The Public Order Act 2023, which is in England and Wales, is the piece of legislation that's kind of been in the news as being controversial for creating new criminal offences for protest, so things like locking on to things and stuff like that. So there aren't, that legislation doesn't create safe access zones in any other context. It just creates other restrictions on protests through other means. Sorry, I probably didn't explain
right,
okay. That.
No, that's fine. And that legislation clearly, if I'm understanding this right, makes a difference between those other protests and the abortion zone legislation in a way that's quite clear in the legislation.
Yeah, yes. Section 9 is singled out as being abortion safe access zones.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks. And Sandish Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. Just to declare my interest as a practicing NHS GP.
Thank you. I'm not getting an indication. Oh, Ross.
Thanks, Convener. Just very briefly, I'm interested in, excuse me, in any of the examples you came across, how the legislation, ordinances, whatever it was, engaged with right to private property. One of the hypotheticals that we're looking at is where private residences would come within the zone. And you know, hypothetically, somebody has a house with a garden, with a flagpole. They can put a flag up on that flagpole. There's then a question of, you know, under this legislation, there's questions around intent, the messaging on the flag, etc. Are there any examples of other bits of legislation where there's been a very clear interaction with private property rights and that has been resolved?
Not as far as I'm aware. I do recall reading about situations where there are like churches within a kind of zone area and what behaviour can happen there. So, you know, could you display a sign like outside the church, that kind of thing. And some of the legislation I've seen makes an exemption for things that happen like within a church. I think there was an exemption for things that happen in some places like within buildings, including often within the medical facility itself is usually exempted. But I haven't come across so much a situation where an individual's property is kind of within the zone and then what are they allowed to do within that private property. And perhaps that has just been because the nature of the zones and where those clinics are, that hasn't been a problem. I guess it depends on the standalone clinics where they tend to be versus, I think, more likely with like hospitals might be more of an issue. Did that answer your question? I didn't know if you're talking about protecting the private property or just where that impacts on the behavior.
Yeah, it's about where it impacts. Exactly the example you give of the, you know, church can put a sign outside just as much as somebody could put a sign in their window. You know, at election time, it's not uncommon for people to put signs in their windows saying which party they're voting for. But in this case, if your house is within the zone, there's an interesting interaction there between the intent of this legislation and ECHR A1P1 rights.
Oh, yeah, for sure. And I suppose that connects back then to the size of the zones as well. So one of the advantages that some people who don't agree with kind of a safe access zone legislation but might prefer the kind of case-by-case basis PSPO approach where you create a zone for a particular clinic, they do mention things like, well, you can target that zone for that specific area, so you could potentially frame it so that you weren't catching people's property or you weren't catching churches. But obviously with the England and Welsh legislation, which is just 150 metres every single clinic, I think you've probably got a higher risk of that happening.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Sandish Gohani.
Thanks again. Just pick up on that point. So from what you said, I don't know if it was, so I'm just trying to ask, is this the only legislation that has specific mention of private dwellings in it, or do they all have them?
Testing my brain power to remember. I don't think it's very common for it to mention anything like that. The context in which private dwellings come up more frequently is in like the Canadian and US legislation, where they're talking about actually protecting those areas, so the homes and residences of like clinic staff and clinic doctors where they've had instances of violence. I haven't, and it's interesting you bring it up, because it really hasn't kind of been on my radar as something, which is making me think that I haven't really seen it in the legislation.
Okay. Can I ask if you could maybe write to us if it is in others, maybe just write to us to let us know.
Yes, to write to you to check that, go back and check the legislation and make sure that private dwellings aren't mentioned.
Thank you.
Gillian McKay.
Thanks, convener. Just a quick question, Emily, about the nature of the different protected sites in each of the legislation. Obviously, in England and Wales, it's very much more a standalone clinic basis than it is here in Scotland, where we're looking at more hospital campuses and the nature of those sites. Is that a consistent theme across the other legislation as well, that actually the sites in Scotland that we're trying to protect are kind of unique compared to many of the other sites that are covered in other legislation around the world?
So not completely unique. I think the Isle of Man, they tend to happen in hospitals, and there's also somewhere else. I'll have to check because now my brain has given up. But there's definitely somewhere else where I remember reading specifically as a note that unusually it said abortions tend to take place in a hospital rather than clinic setting. So no, Scotland isn't unique, completely unique. There are some other examples.
Unusual.
Often they do take place in standalone clinics. And interestingly, actually, some of the research talks about how that attracts protest if it's a standalone clinic. But obviously, hospitals are experiencing that as well. So I'll double check that.
That's lovely. Thank you.
Lovely. Can I thank you, Emily, for your research and also for your attendance at committee this morning. And I will now suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses. Welcome back. And the next item on our agenda is our first evidence session on the Abortion Services Safe Access Zones Scotland Bill. Before I begin, I would will provide a brief introduction to the session. The evidence we will hear today will be in relation to the proposed establishment of safe access zones, and we'll be hearing from individuals with lived experience as part of that. As such, some of the content of this meeting may be sensitive or potentially distressing, and the committee encourages anyone affected by these issues discussed today to seek support. If anyone attending today needs to take a break during the session, please indicate this to myself or the clerks. And I welcome to the meeting Alice Murray, Lily Roberts, Lucy Greaves, co-founder of Back Off Scotland, Rachel Clark, Chief of Staff, British Pregnancy Advisory Service, and Dr. Rebecca Mason, Research and Policy Lead, the Young Women's Movement. Thank you all for coming along today to give evidence to the meeting. I know that some of you are sharing personal experiences with the committee today in relation to the bill, and we really appreciate you joining us to help inform the committee's scrutiny of the bill. Please note there's no pressure or expectation to share anything that you're not comfortable with today. And again, please let us know if you would like to take a break at any point. And I understand that Alice and Lily will begin by setting out their views on the proposed establishment of safe access zones and how this relates to their experiences. And I'll invite Alice to speak first.
Thank you. So it's great to be here today, and thank you for inviting me. I think we're all very glad that it's got to this stage. I know that everyone has my experience handed out, but I think I'll just give a little brief summary in my own words just to start. So I found out I was pregnant in 2019, which was my third year of university at the University of Edinburgh. And before that time, I was aware that the protesters existed. I'd kind of seen their presence before outside Chalmers Clinic and always felt very frustrated. But then when I went to get an abortion, it was a different experience. It was a different experience to seeing them on the street, which I think can be quite anger-inducing, to then actually facing them when you're, you know, going to seek medical care. It's really, you know, it's not something that you expect, I think, in this country. So when I went to Chalmers Clinic, there was around 5 to 7 protesters. I went to the clinic alone. I made that choice. And so they were kind of, you know, they were the only people that I saw out with the healthcare workers inside, who were absolutely brilliant. These protesters, for me, were standing on the other side of the street. So I guess in many ways, it's a weird way to say I feel lucky. There's no lucky experience, but I think, you know, some of the testimonies that you'll hear over the course of this maybe seem a little bit more shocking than mine. But even at that, you know, the long-term impacts of facing the protesters for me have been really significant. It's definitely really impacted the way that I could process my experience and think about my experience. I know that everyone will have questions. I guess the only thing that I would want to kind of raise at this point is that everyone's experience of abortion is very different. And I think for me, one thing that I really like to get across is that I had no emotional kind of attachment or regret or issues around my decision to get an abortion. It was a very easy decision for me. I didn't really think too much about it because I really saw it as a healthcare procedure that I needed to get. But even at that, the experience was, you know, traumatizing. And that, hand on heart, was only to do with the protesters. And I think it's very easy for people to think that, well, you know, an abortion is never going to be a pleasant experience. It's always going to be traumatizing. So, you know, that's kind of just wrapped up in the experience. And it's absolutely untrue, in my opinion. You know, I know for a fact that if the protesters were not there, that experience would have been, you know, the equivalent of getting a tooth out. For me, it was very not a big deal, but the protesters made it a very politicised and stressful experience. So that's just one thing that I'd like you to take into account when I talk about my experience. That's why obviously I support the Safe Access Zones Bill, because I think we need people to be able to access healthcare without the intimidation that I faced.
Thank you, Alice. Lily.
Hiya. So just to go off kind of what Alice said, I had my abortion in 2018 when I just moved to Glasgow for uni, and I went to Queen Elizabeth University Hospital. And that hospital is the one which has had the biggest protests on record. So there were 200 people there at one point. And I think given when I went, there were 15 to 20 people. And the way in which Queen Elizabeth Hospital is kind of the geography of it. There's a small ring road that you have to go around, and there's a small section of road which you can't avoid when you're going in and out of the clinic. And so I went in with my partner at the time, and it was completely unavoidable. And this group of people was very, you simply couldn't avoid it, and it was very intimidating. And they were holding up placards, and I'd always kind of been pro-choice, but I had no concept of the fact that protests happened in the UK. I kind of thought it was a very American occurrence. So coming over here and then being very suddenly confronted with this reality, which I'm sure happens for a lot of other people accessing services too, was something which played on my mind. And similarly to Alice's experience, in terms of me processing the actual abortion, the thing that played in my mind afterwards was solely the protesters being there. And I was in there for quite a while. I was in hospital for about 7 hours. Went in at 7 a.m. and they were all there. I spent the entire time being, rather than thinking about and being present in the moment, I spent the entire time thinking about how I was going to get out. There was an element of feeling trapped and an element of feeling very overwhelmed by their presence. And beyond that, when I was in there, my partner at the time had gone outside for some fresh air and was approached by one of these people. So when they're saying that they're standing there, they're not doing anything invasive, it's very far from the truth, as the other accounts will also have, you know. And they went up and they handed him leaflets containing misinformation about healthcare. And I think it's really important to understand that these people aren't, these protests aren't neutral, they aren't peaceful. There's something very dangerous and malicious about handing out information in that manner. And they would say that they're not aggressive acts, or it's not an act of violence to occupy space like that. But when you are gathering and you're distributing misinformation like that, it's frankly really scary. And buffer zones, if they'd been in place when I had my experience, would have made me feel really safe. And I think safety when you're accessing healthcare isn't much to ask for. So it's a shame we're at this point. But I'm really excited to be here to speak with you all and hopefully push through legislation to, which has a more person-centred approach and makes sure healthcare is accessible and safe and approachable for people in this context.
Thank you, Lily, and thank you again, Alice, for coming along this morning. We will now move to questions for the whole panel, and I'm going to go firstly to Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, convener. Thank you so much for telling us about your stories and what happened. And I just want to start with the Declaration of Interest as a practicing NHS GP. Can I ask, it's a very hypothetical question. If you can't answer it, then absolutely don't answer. The protests that you faced were very much things happening. And you were approached, Lily as well, your partner at the time was. What impact would silent prayers and vigils have had upon you, or potentially, because obviously that didn't actually happen?
Sorry, just to note, that was my experience.
Right.
Yeah, so no one kind of directly approached me. So when I went to my clinic, and sorry, but I wasn't clear on this, it was at Chalmers Clinic in Edinburgh. You're probably familiar with it. So I went in to one end and they were on the other side of the street. There was around 5 to 7 of them and they were engaging in silent prayer. And I mean, I think we also need to note that when they say silent prayer, sometimes it's silent, sometimes they are singing hymns, and they also have signs, which, I mean, now we're getting a little bit technical, but yeah, it's silent prayer, but you're holding a sign that says, you know, abortion is murder, so you're giving out a message. So that was my experience, so I don't really need to think about it hypothetically. That was my experience, is what the protesters say silent prayer is what I experienced. And I can only speak to my own experience, but I know that it was all the same. You know, it was all the more traumatising to walk into a clinic and have people outside suggest that what you're doing is wrong and to question your decision. Is, you know, it's horrible. It's really, really kind of emotionally draining. And so, yeah, I think it's just the same. And I think, you know, we really need to encompass a variety of actions into this, because I think what one person's idea of silent prayer is when they're engaged in it, I think can look very different to the person on the other side who is, you know, alone in accessing healthcare. And so, yeah, that was my experience, was silent prayer.
Thank you. That's very helpful. And can I just open up to other members of the panel? The legislation before us talks does have a part of it which talks about private dwellings, and within the private dwellings, putting up posters, signs within your private dwelling, and if you look at the reasons why that's happening, you can fully understand the reason. So my question to all of the panel, do you think that's proportionate to have that? And do you feel that that versus the right to do almost what you want in your own property is something that's been balanced appropriately?
Hi, I'm Rachel Clark. I am from BPAS. For those of you that aren't aware, we are the largest abortion provider in the UK. We're a charitable abortion provider. We have clinics across England and Wales. We were also very heavily involved in the passing of the English and Welsh law in Westminster last year, and this was actually a question that came up quite a lot with the bill team at the time. What I can say is that we were very clear that there needed to be some provision for private dwellings and other buildings within buffer zones. And the reason for that is that absolutely none of us, I think I can speak for everyone, none of us believe that if you're having a private conversation in your own house, that that should be covered. None of us believe that that should be stopped. However, you can use your private dwelling or another building, something that you own, in order to have exactly the same effect as if those people were stood on a public highway. Our particular concern was around the posting of very large posters in the window with very distressing images. It was around people stood in gardens handing leaflets out over a garden wall where essentially women were having to walk past them. So for us, where we landed with the law in England was that it doesn't cover private conversations within a house or between houses, but it does cover anything that is aimed at women who are in the public space. And for us, that really balanced the rights to ensure that people can do what they want in their home, but they can't inflict it upon people in a buffer zone.
If anyone else would like to come in, or you all agree? Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Can I ask, and obviously we've heard already from Alison and from Lily about their support of bringing in this legislation and introducing buffer zones, but maybe to the other panel members, what would you expect would be the impact of this legislation were it to be enacted, were it to be passed? Lucy.
So hi everybody, my name's Lucy Grieve. I'm co-founder of Back Off Scotland. For those of you that don't know what Back Off Scotland is, it's a grassroots campaign that's looking to secure the implementation of safe access zones around all clinics and medical facilities providing abortion in Scotland. When we started in 2020 with our founding members here, Alice and Lily and myself, we heard a lot of stories about sort of similar experiences to Lily and Alice. But as the campaign started to grow, as we started to get a little bit more press attention, we started receiving testimonies and collecting testimonies from hundreds of women right across Scotland, and the impact that it has on, honestly, the whole cross-section of society is very surprising. I think it's very sort of, you know, easy to think, well, if we have a... If we have, I don't know, some, if we have this implemented, you know, it's going to help abortion patients. And that's great, because one in three women will have an abortion in their life. And it's, you know, one of the most common procedures that a woman will go under. But if you look at how it affects other people, so, for example, we've collected testimonies from women who are undergoing miscarriage management, women that have had sort of much longed for pregnancies, sexual assault victims accessing services, partners of those accessing care, refugees even, and they've all been harassed and intimidated at the hands of a variety of methods of harassment. And I think something that's very important to us is the fact that, you know, when you bring it down to the sort of the base level and you look at things like silent prayer, for example, it doesn't matter if it's silent or if it's, you know, in your face. The actual presence of somebody there targeting you for going for a medical procedure, making a judgment about you, is unacceptable, and I think the impact that this would have on the whole of society will actually be extremely beneficial, and I think it balances the rights well, given that no one will be on either side of the coin. So whether you're pro-choice or you're anti-choice, you just cannot protest and behave like this within a designated zone.
Rebecca?
Thanks very much. For those who don't know, I'm from the Young Women's Movement, and the Young Women's Movement is Scotland's national organisation for young women's feminist leadership and collective action against gender inequality. And our work is led by young women, and it's for young women. So to ensure that young women's voices are centred in this conversation, we engaged with our advisory collective, which is a group of 31 women under 30, and we met with them to discuss their views of the proposed safe access zone bill. And we as a movement, we support the bill because we believe that people who access or provide abortion and associated sexual and reproductive health care services should be able to do so free from intimidation and harassment. And as we noted in our Status of Young Women in Scotland report last year on accessing healthcare, which engaged with nearly 1,000 young women across different parts of Scotland, young women face substantial obstacles when they're accessing sexual and reproductive healthcare in Scotland, and this includes contraception, abortion and post-abortion services. And we as a movement believe that all women should have the right to access safe, high-quality and timely healthcare without fear of being dismissed or ignored by healthcare staff or verbally abused by protesters outside healthcare facilities. And since the publication of our report last year, we've continued to work very closely with young women to better understand how they can have a more positive experience when they're accessing healthcare in their local communities. And at the Young Women's Movement, we believe that compassion, care and concern should be embedded in all healthcare settings and strategies, and that this should start from the initial point of contact when a person is walking through the entrance of a hospital or healthcare facility. Young women told us that even quiet protest outside a facility can be very intimidating for them, and the distribution of leaflets with erroneous information can be detrimental for young women's health and safety. So we believe that the bill will ensure that every person that's entering a clinic or a hospital, for whatever reason that is personal to them and their healthcare provider, is protected from experiencing intimidation and harassment from protesters gathering outside the entrance. And I'll just finish on this point that I think is really important to get put forward now. We believe that the bill doesn't seek to stop or ban anti-choice protests or activity. And this was something that the young women that we engaged with were really, really passionate about. The majority of the women that we spoke to about this bill agreed that the safe access zone should apply to both pro and anti-choice protests. One young woman said, and I quote, "It is an equal bill which would prioritise the peaceful experience of a young woman seeking access to healthcare." So we believe as an organisation that this is a really fair way of policing quite a difficult and contentious issue. We don't think the bill is an attempt to restrict freedom of expression, religion or protest, but it's to safeguard public health and protect the right of women to access abortion and associated reproductive healthcare without obstruction. Thanks.
I'm now going to move to Ross Gray.
Thanks, Convener. The opponents of this bill, those who engage in or support these protests, are going to come and give evidence to Parliament with the same arguments that you'll be familiar with, one of which is that in part they don't see this as a protest, they see this as an opportunity to offer advice, offer an alternative perspective to those who are seeking abortion, seeking reproductive healthcare. I think it's really important that you have the opportunity to answer that claim from them directly. So I'd be interested in your thoughts on that claim, that what they're doing is offering advice and other options that wouldn't otherwise be provided. Well, you addressed that somewhat in your opening remarks, that what they were providing was misinformation, which is of no surprise whatsoever. But I'd be interested in the panel's thoughts on that and what your response would be to that claim.
I think just to speak to my own experience anyway for that, which I think is important, is, and again, I'm not actually 100% familiar with current best practice, and I'm sure Rachel and Lucy will both have a better idea. But for me and my experience, when I went to the clinic, I had, you know, a huge opportunity to learn about other options and to discuss this. Actually, at the time, it was one of the things that I took away from it. I remember saying to a friend that I was really surprised by how long and extended that conversation was. You know, we went through why I wanted to have an abortion, you know, if I was in a safe situation, if I had a partner, all, you know, a variety of safeguarding questions. And I actually found myself kind of saying, like, no, I really want this, I really want this. And I was really surprised about how much that is. And I think that's, you know, that is my response to that, is that that is the appropriate place for that to happen. And I also think there's something to be said for, like, if protesters adamantly think that that conversation doesn't go on inside and that healthcare workers are not doing their job to give a full rounded view of abortion to patients, they need to protest that. They should, you know, they should fight to get that into NHS practice. I don't believe that it's needed, but if that is an actual concern. And I just, in my opinion, I don't think it's a genuine concern of protesters. I think they know that that happens inside because that's not their focus. But also on the flip side of that, another kind of glaring issue is that a lot of the information they do give out is either, you know, factually or medically incorrect. And we can't check the validity of it. We've heard from people who, you know, have maybe been given a leaflet that had medical misinformation. Now, that's really hard for us to track. You know, once that protester is gone and that leaflet's given out, we don't know who's seen that. We don't know if it's children, etc. But yeah, to summarise, in my experience, I think that conversation happens inside, and I think it's entirely inappropriate to happen at the clinic door.
Thank you.
Yeah, so as a provider, I can speak to what happens in our clinics, and I will preface this with, we don't provide in Scotland, but we provide and Scottish providers provide in line with best practice, both international and national. RCOG, the Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynaecologists, are very clear that counselling should be available to women within healthcare services if they require it. They're also very clear that if women don't require it, they should not be forced to go through that, because ultimately women do come to the service, and a very large number of women come to the service knowing that this is the decision that they want to make. They've had that conversation with their friends, with their family, and ultimately they don't need to sit in front of a healthcare professional justifying again and again why it is they need that care. I think what I would say is this is obviously a message that is used against us in England as well. Regulation, I think, is hugely important on this, that as providers, we are both qualified to provide that care and highly regulated as healthcare professionals. That is not something that a random person on the street is. Ultimately, we as a healthcare provider cannot know who those people are. As far as we are aware, they are not trained, they are not qualified, and they are not regulated to provide the quite detailed and quite specialist care that women in really difficult circumstances presenting to abortion services may need. And so for us, ultimately, if this isn't about protest, I think actually they're doing themselves a disservice when it comes to freedom of speech, because what they're essentially asking is to have free access to women who are in a very vulnerable state, and to offer them healthcare services for which they are not qualified or regulated to provide.
Thank you. Lily, were you looking to come in on that point as well? Sorry.
Yeah, I was just going to add in briefly on what Alice said, that I mean, I can't speak for everyone, but I also had very comprehensive options given to me. It's not a case if you walk into a clinic and you're instantly just granted an abortion. That's not how it goes down. You have, with the legal system and how you access it, you have to have, I had two appointments, and both those appointments I had about 30-minute conversations with healthcare professionals. You have to get the approval of two doctors. It's not like it instantly happens. And I think when anti-choice individuals claim that they're offering advice, it's very much hinged on this idea of kind of saviorship, and they're framing themselves as these, you know, providers of care. They can help you come back from, you know, making a bad decision. And in reality, as Rachel said, it's incredibly dangerous what they're doing. And if anything, I think it's very misguided, and it's very naive and rather disrespectful to a healthcare system which is regulated and which is set out to protect people's safety and provide accessible healthcare.
Thank you. Rachel, I'm interested in your perspective from being a service provider down south. Obviously, in a later session, we'll be taking evidence from providers up here to get the perspective of staff. But one of the elements that we need to consider for this bill, obviously, is the impact of the protests on other people accessing healthcare services in the same setting, but also on staff in those settings. And since we've got you here at the moment and you are a provider elsewhere, I'd be interested in BPASS's, not just your perspective, but your experience of the impact on your staff of equivalent protests and vigils down south.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think I'll start by saying that the groups that protest up here are also the groups that protest in England. They are the same people using the same guidelines, supported by the same American-backed organisations. We, as a provider, have spent a lot of time gathering evidence firsthand, both from women who attend our clinics and from staff that provide care. We've got about 3,000 accounts from women and several hundred from staff of their experiences. I think they vary by the kind of protest that they are, and that very much depends on area. But I think the most difficult thing for our staff and our clinics is when a new protest pops up, it is very difficult for me to be able to turn to them and say, this is what's going to be involved, because they vary so wildly that ultimately you're never going to know what to forewarn women about or staff about until they've turned up on your doorstep. And in the meantime, the women that are coming through the door are highly distressed. They need additional care. The people that are providing care for them are obviously then put under time pressure, because they're not just providing that health care. They're essentially providing the kind of counselling service that we've been talking about with the experiences. So you've got women who are coming in, who are crying, who are worried that some of the disinformation they've been given outside may be correct. I think also you have staff who feel... And I think this actually comes back to the question about silent prayer. It's not so much the prayer issue, it's the presence issue. And it's prolonged presence, and it is presence that focuses on the entrance to the clinics. So I think most of our staff would say they know who I am. They know that I'm an abortion provider, and they know that I'm here to help women. That has resulted in some pretty nasty altercations between our staff and the people outside. It's also resulted in some of our staff expressing fear when they're walking to their cars at night, when they're having to walk past them. I've got reports of them being chased down the street in the dark. We have recently had one where someone was followed to her car, and then the next day it was keyed. There's no proof of who that was, but I think it's quite suspicious, if I'm going to put it like that, that that's been what's happening in that area. So I think the impact on staff, actually, it grinds them down, because I think they become quite used to it, inured to it, because they've been there for so long and it happens day in, day out. But when you really begin to dig down with them, actually, the impact on them is really severe, and it really does affect how they feel about their ability to do their job.
Thank you. Does anybody else like to come in on this question of the impact on other people in the facilities, whether that's those who are accessing the facility for reasons other than reproductive health care, other hospital patients, for example? Lucy?
Yeah, definitely. So I think one thing that we were really interested about was when sort of staff members started coming forward to us, as well as people that were accessing services for different reasons. So, for example, we heard from a staff member who worked in the neonatal intensive unit at the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital. And she hadn't had an experience of abortion herself, but she was so frustrated and angry about the fact that her patients and the parents of these babies in the neonatal intensive care unit had to go through that, and the effect that it had. And a lot of times partners get very angry as well, and it's almost as if I worry about what actually happens when, like, someone's set over the edge. I think there's really a big impact on people that we don't really maybe necessarily think that. But then also we heard from a junior doctor at Queen Elizabeth as well, and she'd had an abortion while she was at medical school in Edinburgh. And she spoke very courageously, I thought, about how coming to work every day at the Queen Elizabeth actually meant that she would have to pass the protesters in the morning and then again at night. And it would affect how she provided care to her patients throughout the day. And sometimes she'd go home and cry. And I just thought that was an extremely powerful account of how much this affects everybody. And along with that as well, we have testimonies, like I said earlier, from refugees really at extremely vulnerable points in their lives. And, you know, I think you can imagine the impact that would have on somebody if they were to, you know, be in some of the worst times of their life and have to pass through that and know that people were there to target them because, you know, the signs of pictures on them, it's very clear what they're there to do.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to everyone. Thank you for coming today. The bill talks about protected premises, and there's a definition of protected premises in the bill. And part of the bill also has commitments for like future-proofing aspects of the bill, such as the potential for the scope to extend in the future because persons who are providing support might be GP practices, pharmacies, other areas as well. So I'd be interested to hear on your thoughts around the definition of protected premises and the ability to modify that in the future. I don't know if Rachel maybe wants to come in on that one.
So I think for those of you who may or may not be aware, there's been quite a revolution in the provision of abortion care in recent years, particularly in relation to the administration and the use of early medical abortion and early medical abortion at home. So in Scotland, that's now available up to 12 weeks. It involves taking two sets of medication at home, which prior to 2018, actually were both required to be taken in a clinic. And what we've seen quite rapidly is a change to the way in which women can engage with care in a way that perhaps we didn't see when that drug was first licensed in the early 90s, and certainly did not see in 1967 when the law was passed. And I think what we have seen is that where we have legislation that limits how particularly authorities and ministers can act in relation to updates in best practice, updates in healthcare, that those limitations really do impact on women. So I think for us, in some ways, it is possible to see where that might develop, as you mentioned, in terms of GPs. But I also would quite like us to think bigger. I think that just because of the way we provide abortion now is out of hospitals and out of standalone clinics like Chalmers and Sandiford, that doesn't mean that in 20 years, when we almost certainly will still need safe access zones, that those are not going to be needed around new sites. So I think for us it is quite essential that that power is in there for ministers to enable them to reflect on what current best practice is and make sure that women are protected no matter how that changes.
Thank you. Thanks for that. And thinking about zones, wherever they be in the future, the proposal is for 200 metres in Scotland, which is different than the UK legislation of 150. But just in reading our briefing papers, 150 metres seems to be adequate, except for the Queen Elizabeth Hospital in Glasgow, where there's a part of it that means that people could potentially gather and can be heard from the wards that are providing healthcare for women. So what are your thoughts about the 200 metres in Scotland as a proposal, and then the potential to flexibly allow ministers to extend or reduce those zones?
I can speak to that, and I'm sure Lucy will have something to say as well. I think BPAS focused very tightly in England on 150 metres for the clear reason that for us in England, the vast majority of our clinics are standalone or they're part of GP surgeries. They're on a much smaller scale compared to hospitals, and the mix of women that we have coming is very different. So they tend to be dedicated clinics rather than broad sort of based hospitals where you've got miscarriage, neonatal units, those kind of things. So I think for us, our concern around distance was never about the distance itself, but about the impact that that had on women. And the key things that we were always concerned with was line of sight, so whether women could be watched and be observed and potentially be filmed when they were entering clinics, and also whether they could essentially identify women when they were walking past them so that they could see them come in or out of a clinic and then catch them when they reached the edge of the buffer zone. For us, 150 metres solves that in almost every part of the country. So that is why we chose that distance. It wasn't specifically because we think 150 metres was adequate. And I think Lucy's got some really good reasons as to why that is inadequate in Glasgow. I think for us, 200 metres in Scotland does make the most sense, particularly because of that site in Glasgow. We do also support the ability to extend that where necessary. I think it's right that that sits with the minister, because that means that there has to be a decision based on evidence as to whether that's required or not. We do have some concerns about the ability of the minister, which at the moment in the wording of the bill seems quite unfettered, to reduce the size of a safe access zone as much as they want without any consultation. Our position is that if you're going to have 200 metres as a safe access zone nationally, that should be the minimum to which they can be reduced. So the minister could increase it to 300 and then decide that actually 200 was fine and do that. They shouldn't, in our opinion, be able to reduce them below 200, because at that point we lose the value of having that national legislation and the ability of women to understand what it is that they're walking into and where they're protected. And I think also we would want to make sure that the ability to reduce the area is subject to the same requirements as the increase in area. So looking at the evidence, consulting with providers, consulting with the business owners.
So in the reduction part of the bill, Section 8 in front of me, would you require a further consultation on that rather than just ministers making a decision? Is that something that, you know, any alteration of a zone to, so 200 would be the lowest number, but if it would be, require ministers to do further consultation to make sure that evidence informed any changes to reduction, for instance, of a zone?
Yes, that is what we'd want. And the simple reason for that is we have been in quite a different position in Westminster than you are in Holyrood, where, for instance, our abortion minister at the moment is a former vice chair of the pro-life all-party parliamentary group. We have a very different set of ministers, and our concern has always been about making sure that what we have in statute protects women, and that ministers can make those alterations, but they have to make them in conjunction with the people that are providing the service and ensuring that they are not simply able to do whatever it is they want because of their own personal feelings about abortion. I really wish that wasn't the case and this was treated as healthcare, but ultimately, currently, abortion is still a relatively political issue, and I would want to ensure that women in the future are protected against any potential changes to ministerial opinion that might mean that there was a desire to reduce the protection that we want to give them today.
Okay, thanks. Thank you. Thanks, convener.
Thank you. Ivan McKee.
Thanks very much, convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks very much for coming along and sharing your thoughts with us this morning. The area I wanted to focus on was around about the aspects of the bill that create criminal offences and specifically the approach, which is to prohibit behaviours rather than specific activities. I'd just like to get your perspective on that and your sense of how that would work and any concerns you have or any reasons you think that's the right approach. And also related to that, those sections of the bill also provide for penalties for those breaching the legislation. I'd like to get your perspective on that as well. So I'll just open it up if anyone wants to come in on either of those aspects. So, Rachel, thank you.
I'm very sorry. This is actually a conversation that we had at length at Westminster. The original iteration of our amendment had a specific list of activities that were involved, and it was after quite a prolonged length of discussion within the House of Lords that we concluded that ultimately there was probably more value in having that list of the three things of the impact of behaviour rather than including specific behaviours. Part of the reason for that was that the Supreme Court has obviously ruled on the Northern Ireland legislation with regards to those protections. So our choice was to copy those pretty much as they were, which is what's happened in this bill. I think we support that because there is an element of having that judicial support there already. I think also, ultimately, one of the things that we were trying to do was kind of pin down every aspect of that harassment in a way that it's not always possible to keep up. It was very much like playing whack-a-mole, in all honesty, that you would see one thing happen somewhere and you'd think, oh, that needs to go in the bill. And then you'd see it somewhere else, you'd see something else. And what we didn't want to do was create something where the legislation was always trying to catch up and the anti-abortion groups always sort of had an edge on us because they just needed to act outside the copy of the legislation. So I think for us, the impact is the right way to go. And I think what we can see is that it is working within Northern Ireland. And when the Home Office decides to introduce it in England, I'm quite confident it will be working there too.
Alice?
Just to add on to that, I think, and not to repeat myself from what was discussed earlier, but I think it's an important point here that, you know, I think it needs to be this way because, for example, my experience would come under this, but I think if we were to kind of list exact behaviours in that way, I think it's much harder to track kind of what protesters are doing. And I think it comes back to the protesters who will, you know, ultimately say, well, they were just engaging in silent prayer and they weren't, you know, directly harassing anyone. And I think from my testimony and a few others that we've collected, you know, the impact is really the same.
Okay, thank you. Sure.
I'm very sorry. I realised that you asked at the end of your question about punishment.
Yes.
I think this once again comes back to the Supreme Court conclusion on Northern Ireland, which was that the use of fines was adequate in those situations. We did actually start out with optional prison sentences. We reduced those. So in some ways, whether or not I think that would be the appropriate punishment is a little bit irrelevant, because I think essentially it would put Scotland out on a bit of a limb to be including prison sentences in a bill that isn't currently in place in Northern Ireland or in England and Wales. And I believe I'm right in saying or in the proposed legislation in Ireland either.
Very helpful clarification. Thank you. Just one other thing to ask, and you may or may not want to give any details on this, but talking about behaviours and impact, one of the things that's been mentioned a number of times this morning is inaccurate medical information being given out. I don't know if you've got any examples of that that you'd want to share or not.
Absolutely. So for us, I think there's one key leaflet that seems to make its way around pretty much the whole country. It includes line drawings of fetuses growing. It also includes a poem that starts, "Dear Mum, please don't do anything to harm your baby today." There's a list on that leaflet which includes a large number of inaccurate medical information. That would start with the fact that the erroneous fact that abortion causes breast cancer. That's something that is specifically called out within the NICE guidance and within ARCOG's guidance as not being true. It talks about the mental health impact on women, which is once again disproved in the NICE guidance and the ARCOG guidance. They claim that abortion leads to child abuse and suicidal ideation, neither of which are evidenced. They have no real sourcing of that information, and where that information is sourced, it does tend to be from rather fringe journals with a particular kind of bent, usually from America. Mm-hmm. So I think ultimately those are the kind of things that we see, and those are very familiar messages for anyone that is around anti-abortion groups, the sort of the breast cancer and the impact on women's mental health.
Thank you for clarifying that. Thank you.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. You mentioned America, Rachel, and I forgot to mention that. Like, I was a registered perioperative nurse for 30 years, and I worked in California and England, as well as Scotland as well. And, you know, I'm just thinking about the activities in the States. You know, there's a lot of violence has been perpetrated over the years, and real serious intimidation of persons working in the healthcare as well. So it's whether it's at GPs' homes or doctors or nurse or staff or all of that. So my point is basically that, you know, when we're speaking about persons that are encountering protests, you've talked earlier about staff as well and that. So that's, I guess, the overarching aspects of the bill will protect everybody who is going to their work or going to access healthcare. Is that's what we're aiming for? Is that correct?
Sorry, can I just... Yeah. I would say that's something that came through with our consultation with young women as well. Many of the young women that we spoke to didn't disclose if they had a personal experience, but many of them do work as staff in NHS hospitals and healthcare clinics, and they said that they felt incredibly, you know, attacked every morning that they were going into their job and they were experiencing these sorts of protests. So we think it's really important that the bill is going to not only protect women accessing these services, but protect everyone, especially in Glasgow, such as the Queen Elizabeth Hospital, which is, you know, a hospital that is serving the entire community. It's not solely for an abortion clinic. So we would say that from our perspective, it's really important to remember that the bill isn't specifically just for women access an abortion. It's for everyone to work free from intimidation or harassment as well.
Thank you, convener. Certainly some of the things that have been said, and I just want to say that as a GP, when a woman comes to me asking for abortion, it's not just yes, move on. There's a conversation to be had because it's about safeguarding with what you're saying, and people can conscientiously object, but they have to pass that patient on to somebody who can have that conversation. And I think that is quite important. And if we... I want to talk about human rights. And I'm going to ask really difficult questions, which potentially could be quite triggering. But there are a group of people in our country, and especially in America, who feel that human rights begins at fertilisation. And that's the embryo is a human with rights, and essentially what is occurring is murder. And when you have somebody who has got a view so strong, so set, to use a word like that, they want to be heard. They want their human rights and the human rights of the fetus, the embryo, whatever term you want to give it, we want to give it, they want to give it to be heard. So can I ask for your opinion about what I've just said and what you would say in response? Lucy.
Yeah, so I think one thing to be very clear about is throughout this entire process, it's never been about abortion and about what people think about it or the morality. It's always been about access to care. So whatever somebody thinks about abortion, they're absolutely free to feel that way, and we would never want to change somebody's mind on it that's, you know, so set in their way. We wouldn't want, you know, to have somebody feel as though we were trying to, you know, make everybody pro-choice. But I think having a view like that, it doesn't make sense to me why you'd be going directly to the woman, targeting them. And I'd also say, along with that, if they want to change the law, they can come to Parliament. And also, I think just because they have a, you know, a right to freedom of speech, a right to freedom of assembly, you know, whatever, they don't have a right to an audience. They don't have a right to have, you know, people listening to what they have to say. And particularly not, you know, vulnerable women that are actually trying to uphold their own rights, you know, like medical privacy, right to a personal life. And I really feel like that's something that when we're getting asked questions about human rights, it's very, very much sort of the questions always revolve around what about the rights of the protesters, what about the rights of the people attending these vigils, but actually the rights of the women who are being targeted are very often sort of left as a last thought.
Does anyone else have a thought?
Sorry, yeah, I obviously agree with Lucy. I think, you know, we're still going to see anti-choice or anti-abortion protests in this country, and that's okay. You know, they usually do one every year on Lothian Road. I live in Glasgow. There's often protests on Buchanan Street. That will still happen. Like, this bill is not trying to get rid of that. And also, you know, their huge online presence. And I think, as Lucy said, this issue, it's not about the morality of abortion. And, you know, we're not here to have that conversation. We're here to talk about the exact procedure at the clinic door, which is why, you know, it's called a safe access zone. So I think it's really balanced, in my opinion.
Thank you. And I want to ask, sort of slightly off topic, if I may. In Alabama, we've seen new legislation coming in on what constitutes a human. And that's obviously going to make a huge difference to IVF treatment over there. Do you think that, and that's a huge difference that's happened in Alabama. Things obviously change, opinions change, people change, our thinking changes as time goes on. Do you think this legislation is going to give us some future safeguardings on things like that have happened?
I think, first of all, I just want to say, in case anyone probably couldn't guess, that I think what has happened in Alabama and what has happened across much of the US is a travesty for human rights, for women's rights, and for their ability to live their lives as the free human beings that they are. I think that what we have seen has been disgusting, quite frankly, and I cannot ever countenance the idea that any of us in this room or beyond would allow something similar to happen in this country. I can't, because I think it is so far beyond what the British public believe in, what the Scottish public believe in. I think what we can see is that this law will be in place for as long as the Scottish Parliament wants it. Ultimately, the Scottish Parliament has the ability at any point to overturn it. If at some point, God forbid, that they decided that ultimately human beings are human beings from the moment of fertilisation, they could get rid of this law. But my feeling is that that isn't going to happen. And what is required is future-proof legislation that enables us to maintain this protection for as long as we need it. And unfortunately, our experience is that these kind of protests, although they got much bigger and much more organised in about 2014, have been going on since the Abortion Act passed. I've got no reason to believe that without this law passing, that these would stop of their own accord, or that they're an issue for this time. They are something that has been used over many, many decades to induce fear in women who are trying to seek to exercise their fundamental legal rights.
So my question was sort of, at the moment, obviously there is no protest that occurs outside of an IVF clinic. But given what happened in Alabama, suppose that does happen, do you think bills like this would give us the flexibility to be able to future-proof anything that happens in the future? Or do you think that actually we need to maybe come back and relook at it if something happens?
I think from our perspective, we are not proposing that this is something that is used elsewhere. This is a very particular issue. It has many, many years of evidence. It has thousands of sort of bits of information from women and from providers behind it. I am not fundamentally opposed to similar laws elsewhere, but the evidence has to be there. And I think for us, it is very clear that when it comes to abortion clinics, the evidence is there. If in future very similar things were happening elsewhere, then I would be more than happy to come and talk to the Scottish Parliament about why we needed that protection. But I think you're right that at the moment, that's not where we are. And I wouldn't want those changes to happen without the same kind of scrutiny that the committee is giving to this bill, because they are, I really recognise, I think we all recognise, that these do have impacts on human rights of protesters. It is simply that those rights have to be balanced with the rights of women. And ultimately, when it comes to abortion, our conclusion is that those are most adequately balanced by the introduction of safe access zones.
Thank you.
And David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to witnesses. There's individuals and groups out there who would argue that there are existing criminal offences which deal with behaviours such as harassment and threatening behaviour. In your view, why are these insufficient to deal with protests outside abortion clinics?
This is just an experience that I had when I used to live around the corner from Sandyford Clinic. And just as an example of how I think people being dealt with by existing legislation doesn't quite cover it, I went and observed when there were two protesters who frequent that clinic very regularly. And these two individuals had megaphones and they were chanting hymns and preaching very loudly over these megaphones into the clinic. And the police were called, they came. And from my experience of seeing how police officers dealt with this situation and from speaking to them, they felt as if existing legislation there was, but that there was nothing they could do. It's not explicit enough and it's not contextually bound enough to what's happening. They took the megaphones off them because that was, I wouldn't know the legal jargon, but because that would be kind of infringing peace or however it would be phrased. But once they took the megaphones off them, they started screaming into the clinic. And this clinic in particular provides sexual assault and rape counselling. And there were people entering the clinic for these reasons and they were screaming into this clinic verbal abuse. And so I think it goes back to the complexity of different actions and how you class it, and that's why impact is such an important approach to have, because existing legislation doesn't really cover that or account for that. So, yeah.
Lucy?
Totally echo what Lily's saying, but I also think one thing to bring into it is the stigmatisation of abortion. Before we started our campaign, we hadn't really heard many stories. You know, we'd looked at what BPAS had done in England and what Sister Supporter had done in England as well with their sort of local campaigns around Ealing Council, for example. But I actually think that people just didn't talk about this until it became an issue in the media. And when we got sort of people reaching out to us and, you know, for the hundreds of stories we've collected, people never knew what they could do. And the last thing that they want to do is go into an abortion clinic and call the police because they're going through a difficult day. And the absolute last thing on their mind is, you know, involving the police. Having to go through a process that's going to make the day harder. And I really think now that we're talking about it more and there's been more sort of light shed on it, and you know, people who wouldn't normally see the gates of a medical facility that provides abortion can see what these women are having to go through. It's really changed the conversation around it. Rightly, I think. I definitely think the stigmatisation and maybe the conversations we've been having are, I'm not sure, just changing the chat.
Can I say thank you to all the witnesses? Can I just ask, is there any other issues relating to a bill that the committee haven't covered that you'd like to bring up? Lucy?
Sorry, I think one thing for us is there's been changing tactics since we started our campaign from the protesters, those that are attending vigils. You know, first when we started, it was very much about it's not legal to limit the rights of protesters or freedom of speech. Once the Supreme Court Northern Ireland ruling came through, that really, you know, changed into, oh, we're here to help and counsel women. But actually, fundamentally, the thing that underpins this all, it's nothing to do with, the women, and it's nothing to do with, you know, fighting for their rights. It's all to do with them wanting to ban abortion outright. And I think, actually, when we see how blatant and transparent this is, you know, messaging on the website of one of these protest groups, they say that they want to, you know, end the scourge of abortion. These people aren't, you know, quiet, kind, you know, people that are just trying to go about their days and help people. They are backed by some very, I'd say, dangerous people that are really trying to come for our reproductive rights, and in particular, our right to abortion.
Anybody else? Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Can I thank the panel for the evidence this morning? You've certainly helped the committee in our scrutiny of this bill. At our next meeting on the 5th of March, we'll continue to take evidence as part of the committee's Stage 1 scrutiny of the Abortion Services Safe Access Zone Scotland Bill. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today.